instead of loving each other. I'm up here saying black people gotta unite.
She recognized the white man as her enemy and is trying to find reasons to love him. Read John 3:16. Read.
ISUPK.
Y'all see a problem? When the scripture just said it's a time to love and a time to hate. Now, I was going to show you where God hates the white man. But before I show you where God hates the white man, we're going to read Matthew 5 and 33. Please read Matthew 5 and 33. Please read that.
Matthew chapter 5, verse 43. Ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy.
Now, does anybody know where this was said when Christ said it? You see how the beginning of the verse it says, ye have heard that it has been said. Y'all read that part again.
Ye have heard that it has been said.
Now, Christ is quoting something. That's why he said, ye have heard that it has been said. So now, does anybody know where it was said? What he about to say? It was said in the book of Leviticus, the 18th chapter, when it said to love your enemies, excuse me, love your neighbors. Now, if he's talking to the children of Israel in Leviticus, the 18th chapter, who is he talking to in Matthew's, the 5th chapter? He's also talking to the children of Israel. The enemy, and during this time, we was enemies to each other. The northern kingdom and southern kingdom of Israel were separate from each other. So we're the ones that became the enemies. That's why when that white woman came to Christ, what did Christ tell her? I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Keep reading.
But I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you.
Now, the enemies that we're supposed to love is us. What Christ was bringing, you can get that scripture copy. What Christ was bringing out is the end of black on black crime. You had the Jews that hated the Israelites. Why am I saying it like that? The northern kingdom was called the house of Israel. The southern kingdom was called the house of Judah. That's why you had two kingdoms. The reason why they got split is because they hated each other. So when Christ is saying, love your enemies, that's the enemy that he's talking about. Show me a verse where Christ ever said he came for anybody but the children of Israel.
He
never said that.
And
I'm not, listen, I told y'all I was a prophet, right?
So
I told y'all, when I showed y'all what Matthew 5 and 43 was going to do, y'all was going
to
do what? Find another scripture. So I'm fine with that. Let's get John 3:16 now. Listen, hold Michael 7. Let's get John 3:16. Listen, that's the white man's favorite scripture, and his love with a black woman, that's her favorite scripture too. Now, after I show who the world is, let's see if she still defends him or stands with black men. That's why we can't unite. The reason why black people can't come together, because they're too busy loving white people instead of loving each other. I'm up here saying black people gotta unite. She recognized the white man as her enemy and is trying to find reasons to love him. Read John 3:16. Read.
No better than
the book of John, chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world.
Woo!
I got one question for the crowd. Just one question. When Christ said, for God so loved the world, who was he talking to when he made this thing? Hold on, don't answer it yet. I'm going to read the whole thing for you. Read it.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Ain't that a beautiful scripture, y'all? Beautiful scripture. Now the question I got is, when Christ made that statement, who was he talking to? Who knows the answer?
Everyone.
He was talking to everyone?
Everyone.
He had no enemies. He was talking to everybody. Anybody else?
No enemies.
God. So who was he talking to? When he said, for God, say again? He was talking to sinners, right? So he made that, so what you say, sis, is that he made that statement to everybody when he said it, right? Let's find out the truth. Read John 3:1.
The book of John, chapter 3.
When I say the truth, I'm not talking about, I'm not going to hypothesize, you can't hypothesize. We're going to read who he was talking to right now. So then you can't say it's my words.
But there's words and there's faith.
No, but there's words of who he's talking to right here. Read John 3:1.
The book of John, chapter 3, verse 1.
Now this is the beginning of the book, so you can understand who the conversation is between. Read.
There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews.
So now Nicodemus is a Jew. He's a Pharisee. He's a ruler of the Jews. Keep reading.
The same came to Jesus by night.
Say what?
Came to Jesus by night.
So everybody believes that when he said, for God so loved the world, that he made that statement in front of everybody, like how I'm in front of y'all. But in reality, it was just a conversation between two Israelites. It was not a conversation between everybody, sis. It was a conversation. If I was talking to this brother one-on-one, I'm talking to him one-on-one. That's the first mistake that people make. Now let's get to the word world. Give me John 17:9. Everybody looks at the word world and believes that the word world means everybody on the planet. World just means ages or society. The world that you live in, for example, China's world is not America's world. Their society or the way that they live over there is not the same here. The black man's world and the white man's world is different. It's just the age of society that you live in. So now, John 17:9. Now remember, for God so loved the world, right? John 17:9.
Stay focused.
John 17:9. I pray for them. So now, there's a people, this is written in red. There's a people that Christ prayed for. He said, I pray for them. Read.
I pray not for the I pray not for the world.
So why did it bring to John 3:16? If John 3, I got you.
Stay focused.
So now, if John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, John 17:9 says, I pray for them, meaning I pray for certain people, I pray not for the world, then we would first have to understand that there's a context when it comes to the word world. Wouldn't you have to agree? That depending on where you see it at, it could be talking about something different, right? Now, what if I can show you in the scriptures that the word world is talking about Israel? Can we then stop with John 3:16? I guarantee you can. Give me a second. There she does. You see how she ran away? The scripture said a wicked flee, no man pursue it. Now, she made the it, I answered it with scripture, not my conjecture. And she ran away. That's the problem. Nobody wants to face the truth. One of the greatest things Christ said was, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. It didn't say the truth was going to make you feel good. And I know you think it feel good to love white people, but white people just want you to die. Either they want you to die, or they want you to make our money for them, or they want you to kill for them. You got Isaiah 45 and 17?
My Father, just as you are mine, and I am in you, may they also be in us.
No, no, you got Isaiah 45 and 17. All right, you got Isaiah 45. Now remember, we talk about the word world. She brought up the word world, that her white dog left you, her white master left. Let's see how long she stayed. Now, she said John 3:16, for God so loved the world. So let's see if Israel is called that world. Read Isaiah 45 and 17. Read.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 45, verse 17. But Israel shall be saved.
I love the Lord. I love him. And I love these goddamn scriptures. Read that again.
But Israel shall be saved.
Lord, the word just said Israel shall be saved. It didn't say a white man. It didn't say African or Arab. It said Israel. The good news, black people, you're right here on this side. You look on this side. We say Israel. We talk about everybody that's on this side. You on this side, Lord loves you. And the Lord gonna save you. Keep reading.
But Israel shall be saved in the Lord with an everlasting salvation.
Everlasting meaning they never going to stop. Keep going.
Ye shall not be ashamed.
Now you know why I say you shall not be ashamed? Because sadly, black people, you don't even want to be black. That's why the way you dress is like the white man now. I be seeing cats with skinny sweatpants on. I ain't never heard of that a day in my life. They done went from skinny jeans to skinny sweatpants. In the gym, working out with skinny sweatpants. I ain't never seen that in my life. The way you dress your hair is based on a white man. The way you act as a feminine black man is based on following after the white man. So we're not going to be ashamed, read.
Ye shall not be ashamed nor confounded.
Now you know who's confounded? She is. And that other black woman that left. Defending the white man. Defending the white man will always be the failure of black people.
Amen.
Loving the white man will always be the failure of black people. You can't even ask Martin Luther King because he dead. He tried. Listen, not only did he love black white people, he loved that white woman more than he loved black women. His first woman in college was a white woman. And the only reason he stopped dealing with that white woman in college is because he wanted to be a civil rights leader. And it would look bad him being with a white woman instead of a black woman. Just look up his first woman. In college, he was with a white woman. Now, it said, you shall not be ashamed nor confounded. Read.
World without end.
Say it again.
World without end.
Say it again.
World without end.
Israel is that world. Israel, slide down just a little bit. Israel is the world that Christ was talking about. You got 1 John 2 and 15? Please read that, please. 1 John 2 and 15. Love not the world.
Say it again.
Love not the world. So now, John 3:16, for God so loved the world. John 17 and 9, I pray for them, I pray not for the world. And this John, 1 John 2 and 15 just said what? Love not the world. Now this just said love not the world. So why do they act like John 3:16 only? That means everybody. Y'all gotta wake up out of the drug called Christianity. Like a Christian is worse than a crackhead. And you know why a Christian is worse than a crackhead? Because at least a crackhead know they are crack and know that it's wrong. A Christian don't even believe Christianity is wrong. Even though they can read in the Bible, like they believe, hey, Cotters, I can't have that sign, please, brother, for sure. Do what? I appreciate that. Like, Christians will read the Bible where it say Jesus has hair like wool, skin of bronze, but still pray to this basket. Listen, they'll look at him when they say, I use this term all the time. When they say, they I lay me down to sleep, this is the bastard they think about. Right here. Even though they can read in Revelation, the first chapter, to tell you to call on Christ. Christianity is the worst drug that can ever hit blacks and Hispanics. My Spanish brothers, y'all love Jesus, y'all love Mary, y'all love God, y'all love all having all them chains on your neck of Columbus and St. Maria and St. Anthony and Augustus and all of that. And meanwhile, we're dying following that. Meanwhile, when you do the history of Christianity, Columbus, when he came over here, in the name of white Jesus, they enslaved all of us to that entrapment. Now, I got to show y'all God hates the white man, because that's how we started. So give me Romans 9 and 13, one of my favorite true blue scriptures, because it's how I can hate the white man. Listen, here's something that plagues black people. The word hate plagues black people a lot. And it's not really your fault that the word hate plagues you that way. The reason why when y'all hear us say you gotta hate the white man, you immediately get this defensive mode on it, because y'all believe he's saying hate the white man the way the white man hates you. So when you think of the white man's version of hate, you think of the drug epidemic. You think of the feminist movement where they kick the black man out the house. You think of the violence where you going around, where the white people are going around killing us for no reason. So when you think of the word hate, when we say hate the white man, you're like, man, I can't do that. I've been hating the white man damn near all my life. And I thought, up until 33, I thought it was wrong. But I couldn't stop hating the white man because my father put that in me. It wasn't until I found that I was an Israelite and I found that it was fine and found out exactly what it meant that I was truly free. When we're saying hate the white man, I'm not telling you to harm a white man. I'm not telling you to fight a white man. All I'm telling you is to take all that love that for all your life you've been trying to give them, take it away from them. I'll give you an example. We about to come up on Thanksgiving, right? Don't celebrate his Thanksgiving. That's his love. That's his love for killing the Native Indians. His love for killing the Puerto Ricans. His love for killing the Cubans and the Mexicans and the Argentinians. All of the people in North Central and South America that was living in peace before he came in here, that's his love. If you say, thank you, his love for having his land at the expense and death of your ancestors. So when I'm saying hate him, when you love him, you actually hating your ancestors. Do you think your ancestors that's buried in the ground would appreciate you celebrating Thanksgiving? Hell no. So what I'm really telling you to do is have some honor. Have some dignity. After that, you got Christmas. Now, stop loving the white man and don't celebrate Christmas no more. Christmas ain't got nothing to do with black people. But black people go broke on Christmas. Black people go broke, can't pay their rent, can't pay their car note, can't pay their light bill. They kids playing with the toys that they gonna break the same goddamn day. When I'm saying hate, now, imagine you don't celebrate Thanksgiving, you don't celebrate his Christmas, you don't use his drug, you don't sell his drug. You gonna need to channel that love somewhere, right? Love your brother. We're so quick to forgive the white man for his offenses, but the brother that lived next door that we got into an argument with, we'll shoot him. We'll stab him. We'll snitch on him. We'll do all the things against him, but we never think, let me try to get along with this brother. Let me try to get along with this sister. I ain't never had an argument with that. But when I say we got to separate from the white man, and I'm laying it out what I'm talking about, now what am I saying that's wrong? Don't the white man do the same thing? Nobody accuses the Jewish man of being racist. And y'all know the Jewish man sticks to his home. They got places in Brooklyn that they got their own city, their own synagogues. You can't even get citizenship in Israel without becoming a Jewish man. And nobody calls them racist. Chinatown is where, Kadazan?
There.
Oh, it's right there? I'm from Jersey, Slack. I'm from Jersey. Two blocks away is Chinatown. Nobody calls them racist for having Chinatown, for having their China stores. Now, they so racist, not only do they have their stores in Chinatown, they got their stores in your neighborhood. But they're not called racist. But we're called racist for telling y'all to do the same thing that every other race is allowed to do. It's supposed to be a privilege. Right, and we can't put a black business in Chinatown. You go, say it again. You go open up a soul food restaurant in Chinatown. You won't get not one permit for it. The city will shut you down. But there's a China store on every goddamn corner in Boston. On every corner, there's a Chinatown. Excuse me, China store. And they don't hire you. They don't hire you. There's a Chinatown. There's a 7-Eleven with them goddamn Adams and Habib's and the Dunkin' Donuts. Every business can flourish in your neighborhood, but you can't have your business. And I'm going to tell you something. We love them too much. Because if a black business opened up in a black neighborhood, we won't patronize it. You know why? Because we loving everybody else. So because he got that love for everybody else, I can't buy the sneakers from my homie. I gotta go to Foot Locker and get the sneakers. Even though if I buy the sneakers from that brother, maybe he'll start having his business. His business will come up and we'll have our own commerce. Now, the same thing with that brother, that devil, that white boy, that said it's not about hate, we gotta come together.
Oh, hey,
Black Wall
that?
Street came together. You know what they did to Black Wall Street? They burned that thing to the ground. They threw aircrafts over Tulsa, Oklahoma, and dropped the names down to the ground. But she wants me to love my enemy. She wants me to forgive this so-called enemy. When what has that enemy ever done to require forgiveness? And who has he ever forgiven? Who has the white man forgiven? The white man forgave the Arabs? They still in the Middle East. They ain't never coming out of the Middle East. They still over there. The Jewish man still got an issue with the Germans. They be catching 95-year-old German soldiers that had a hand in Hitler's war and locking him up saying he escaped justice. The devil 95 years old. But it means something to them. They never forgiven anybody a day of their life, but they require yours because the white man only has compassion for himself. He would never have compassion for you. So we don't need his compassion. Let me tell you something. I don't need a white man's forgiveness. I don't need to ask me forgiveness. I don't need it. What I need is for my brothers to forgive each other. That's probably the most important thing that we have is our own power is in who we give our love to. You want to know why the white man great? Because we gave our love to him. America was built on our blood, our intelligence. When Booker T. Washington and all them smarts that they had, who designed the damn Washington, D.C.? A brother. Now, Madeline took them smarts and left it to us. And don't be afraid. Now, here was the problem back then. When they bombed Tulsa, Oklahoma, we got weak. We saw Tulsa, Oklahoma get bombed, and we like, the white man is too much. When you at war, there's going to be casualties. But you got to go to war. So now the war that we're in is a spiritual war. Who we give our love and our affinity to. Imagine if we never sold crack no more. Never sold that dope. Never got high. We would cripple America. Ronald Reagan and them was the one that brought the damn drugs. At the same time, Barbara Bush talking about down with crack. Her daddy, her husband, bringing the damn crack in with our help. That's why we call the white man the devil. Because the white man, we call him a devil or a snake. Pale face, speak with a forked tongue, say one thing, do the other. That's the husband and wife. One saying we're against drugs. One saying, man, get the CIA to fire out of it in here. Now imagine if we do it. We will cripple this. We will cripple it. Now let me show you God hates the white man. I ain't gonna let y'all go. Let me show y'all. Give me Romans 9 and 13. Read that, believe.
The book of Romans, chapter 9, verse 13. As it is written.
See again. Now, when it says as it is written, now what I like about this Paul saying this. Because usually white people try to say Paul was white, Paul was not white. Paul was from the tribe of Benjamin. If you saw Paul today, he would be a Jamaican or a West Indian brother. That's Paul, right? Paul is writing this, and they always like to say Paul taught to the Gentiles, which he did. But the Gentiles was us, the Israelites that was living in Rome, in Galatia, in Cappadocia, in Asia Minor. That was us. Everybody with me. So now it says, as it was written, meaning this was written somewhere else. Read.
Jacob have I loved?
So now, God does love with people. Like, God is the reason all nations are on the face of the earth. So the Arabs, the Chinese, the Africans, everybody on the face of the planet, because God made sure. Now, just like any creator, you can have a favorite. You can have a special. Even if a brother got like 4 or 5 kids, he has a favorite child. Now, that don't mean that he don't give them all something, but there's that one child that means more to him than the other children. So in this case, it said, who did he love?
Jacob, have I loved?
It said, Jacob have I loved. Meaning he loved Jacob or the children of Israel. Keep reading.
But Esau.
Who?
But Esau.
Now, a lot of people, y'all notice I've been saying so-called white man, right? Because the white man's not really white, he's red. Why do we say so-called white man? Because really, in the Bible, he's Esau, or the Edomites of the Bible. Jacob and Esau were brothers fighting since the womb. And it said, Jacob have I loved, but Esau what?
But Esau have I hated.
I thought it said God don't hate. I thought it said God love everybody. It just said, Esau have I hated. So then that means that there's a people on the face of the planet that God actually hates. And that's the white man. So y'all wonder why we fail? Like, do y'all believe we stronger than the white man? Ain't we stronger than the white man? We smarter than them too, right? We so smart. I'm gonna tell you how dangerous black people are when we unite. Just look at history. Black Wall Street was built in the early 1900s. You think about maybe now the pinnacle was 1921? That we started in the early 1900s. Some